The reigning SEC East champs make their way to action, and an upbeat atmosphere welcomes them. The swamp is overflowing with optimism. Coach Mack delivered in year one. Everyone now wonders what's next for Florida. It's time for the answers. Who's the next defensive star of a reloading elite group? All SEC corner Jalen Tabor is primed to be just that. As for who'll be throwing passes, a battle continues. Luke Del Rio has looked the part. A Gator for the past year, he gets his first chance to show it. Grad transfer Austin Appleby has the experience and the attitude. And the new kid in town, early enrollee freshman Felipe Franks, he comes in with all the buzz. It's prime time in Gainesville. The orange and blue debut. Spring in the swamp with plenty to jump. Presented by Regions Bank. It's the orange and blue debut, a chance for Gator fans to see their team's final spring prep for another big year ahead in the SEC. As we say good evening, everybody, glad you're with us, Joe Tessitore and Greg McElroy. Year one for Coach McElwain, 10-4. Win the SEC East. Have a good year in what was supposed to be a rebuilding year, but as Coach Mack said, that was an overachieving group that became a too much satisfied group. It was a blowout loss in the bowl. 12 new faces come in to this spring practice. Where are they?
They're much further along than where they were a year ago. I came and watched this team practice in the spring in 2015, and I really wondered if they would get to a bowl. Getting to 7 wins would have been an incredible task. This team improved an awful lot over the course of the summer. Right now, so far ahead as far as identifying playmakers. They have a very good frontline talent. Just identifying who's going to be the depth.
Identifying depth, position battles, always the key to spring ball. And the quarterback room here at Florida, completely new. 4 new faces, 2 veterans, 2 early enrollees.
And it's really interesting because if you look at Luke Del Rio, he's a well-traveled veteran going into his sophomore year, been at 2 different schools prior to getting here to Gainesville. Austin Appleby started a lot of games in the Big Ten. Will not be surprised by the bright lights tonight. And then 2 freshmen who perhaps might be more talented arm talent-wise than the 2 guys in front of them. It's just whether or not they can learn the offense and make the plays necessary to be successful.
Let's touch on the other side, the Florida defense. A lot of NFL-bound superstar talent left the program, but still, elite-level talent remains.
What's great about this Florida defense is the fact that they still have guys on every single level that will play a long time in the National Football League. Yes, they lost some superstars. You lose Jonathan Bullard. In comes Caleb Brantley, number 57. Keep an eye on him. He'll be all over the field tonight at the defensive tackle position. At linebacker, Jared Davis thought briefly about going to the National Football League. Still felt like there was an awful lot that he could accomplish. And finally, Jalen Tabor, moving into his junior year. Obviously had a remarkable year last year when it came down to production. Now he's the featured guy. He's the island corner. Will he be able to step up the way guys before him have?
The SEC and passes broken up a year ago. Down to the field we go. Thrilled to have Laura Rutledge with us. Good evening, Laura.
Well, good evening, Joe. And we're here with Coach McElwain. Coach, we're going to get to see your quarterback battle on display tonight. What are you looking for from these guys?
Well, I'm kind of just hoping to see kind of how they, what a great crowd, and this is a lot of fun, and how they kind of handle the atmosphere. That's kind of why we wanted to do this at night, get a little energy. Let the guys know what it's going to be like and really just see how they operate.
Plenty of other position battles going on as well. What are you most interested in other than the quarterbacks?
Well, obviously, you know, how we play up front and kind of who dominates the line of scrimmage. That's something we've really been talking about, and we've got to get a lot better at that. Love to see them make some plays on the outside. Hopefully we get some explosive plays for the fans, but if not, we got pretty good defense.
All right. Well, thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Coach Mack.
So some of those explosive plays could come from the running backs, and that's another position battle that's going to keep going on. You've got Jordan Cronkright, Jordan Scarlett, also Mark Thompson and Mark Herndon. And Cronkright and Scarlett have made big strides going into their second years. Herndon is a guy that is finally healthy. And then there's Mark Thompson. Now, you're going to want to look out for this guy. He may be hard to miss at 6'2 and 242 pounds. The junior college transfer has shown a quick first step through the hole. He's shown that he can adjust to the college game, and they're excited about him, not only because of his size, but also, Joe, because he can catch the ball out of the backfield just as some of these other running backs can.
Boy, is he a get-off-the-bus kind of guy, Laura. Mark Thompson, 6'2", 242, but he's got good feet. He's got that jump cut in the hole. And as Coach Mack says, you look at him, it doesn't take long to realize he is what an SEC running back should look like.
There's a few that look an awful lot like him. One in Knoxville, and Jalen Hurd, and someone that took home the Heisman Trophy last year named Derrick Henry, both of which about 6'3", 230, 240. Thompson's going to be a guy to watch tonight, number 24.
Four 12-minute quarters with a running clock tonight here in the orange and blue debut. We are going to have two-minute drills at the end of each half, and there will be no live kickoff or punt returns, but the Florida fans have been waiting for this. It is the debut of Eddie Pinero, the much-heralded live-leg new kicker for the Gators, as he drills this one and knocks it all the way to the back of the end zone. They look to see his strong leg throughout the fall. So the quarterback race, a big part of our conversation tonight, as you see Luke Del Rio, who has never started a college football game, but played in three games, most recently at Oregon State. Spent the past year here at Florida, was with the team, sat out due to the transfer rules, started his career at Alabama, so familiar with the offensive system of Nussmeier and Matt Lewin. And Jordan Cronkright gets the start as the running back here with the blue team on offense. And Cronkright will keep the legs moving out past the 30-yard line, out to the 33, where he is tackled by Matt Rowland. You know, I bring up the fact that Luke Del Rio, Greg, was on the scout team sitting out last year. We had a great conversation with him yesterday. He said, man, let me tell you something. That is not my nature. It is uncomfortable for me to play that role of a scout team quarterback saying, you have to throw it here. You are going to throw an interception.
He said he butted heads occasionally with defensive players and the defensive coordinator. He's not used to throwing interceptions. He said he wanted to make it hard on the defense. He did a pretty good job of that. This defense was exceptional last year.
As Cronkright splits out wide, empty set for Del Rio. His first pass of the game. And a good start for Del Rio, complete to C.J. Wharton with good yards after the catch as Wharton continues downfield with a big gainer to about the 21-yard line, finally chased down by Christian Garcia.
Usually you like to see your quarterbacks get off to a high percentage start, maybe something underneath. Not so fast. C.J. Wharton on the seam route. Del Rio, nice back shoulder, not throwing him into contact. You can tell he's comfortable. That ball came out on time. Good start for the sophomore out of Denver, Colorado.
46-yard completion to start the evening for Luke Del Rio. And run power here with Cronkite. And another good gainer down to the 14-yard line, tackled by David Reese. Cronkite, a sophomore from Miami. He has been the front runner so far this spring, but it is a very talented and deep group of running backs, as Laura noted.
He's kind of a perimeter guy, a guy that can play out on the edge, has top-end speed. He just has to excel when it comes to getting downhill, and that's been a point of emphasis for him this spring. Done a nice job of it on his first two carries tonight.
He was one of the first recruits after Coach McElwain came on board. Second down and three. Del Rio's second pass of the night. And it goes for a touchdown to DeAndre Goolsbee. Great start for Luke Del Rio.
You can see this is a route that Goolsbee made a living catching last year. A little wheel route right off the right sideline on time. That's what you have to be in the red zone. We talked about Del Rio has not played a ton of football at this level, not in game times, only 18 career attempts, but early here tonight, on time, accurate, and decisive. That's exactly what Jim McElwain wants to see.
And it's what the Florida faithful want to see as well, a little bit of offense. Remember how much they sputtered down the stretch of last season. So Coach Mack's blue team, number one offense, able to come right down the field. 14-yard touchdown pass, Del Rio to Goolsbee. Rio, 2 for 2 for 60 yards and the touchdown pass. What did he show you out of the gate, Greg?
Well, he looked under control. He was very decisive, like I just alluded to. 3 steps on the drop, 1 hitch, ball's out. This is a group up front along the offensive line that has been prone to giving up sacks. It's a large part due to what they're doing up there, but it's also because the quarterbacks last year would hang onto the football just a little bit too long. Del Rio has made a point of emphasis this spring, getting the ball out of his hands. At times, he's gotten a little greedy, but right there, he took exactly what the defense gave him, made 2 very nice throws early, and that's the start you want under the lights here in the Swamp.
And 13 sacks in their last 3 games of 2015 given up by that offensive line. 45 sacks given up overall. But a well-managed and good finishing first drive for the blue team. So we saw Luke Del Rio, and now comes the grad transfer, Austin Appleby. He's from North Canton, Ohio. Comes in from the Big Ten, having played at Purdue. Started 11 games there. Had 19 touchdowns framed against 19 interceptions when playing at Purdue.
He said he loves having a defense that he can rely on. At Purdue, occasionally had to force the football. Here, obviously, Florida, known for their defense. 7 top 10 defenses the last 10 years. He knows he just has to play within the offense, lean on the run game, and make good decisions.
Jordan Scarlett will get the carry to open up this game. He has been in and out of this spring with a hamstring issue. Had a strong game in the win against Georgia last year, the sophomore from St. Thomas Aquinas downstate.
You mentioned the 99-yard game against Georgia. He was also suspended for the Citrus Bowl. So it's been important to make sure that he gets back on the coach's good side. He's worked hard. He recognized the mistakes. He's moving forward, ripping off the rearview mirror, and trying to get involved in this running back rotation.
Austin Appleby out of the shotgun on 2nd and 7. Young man who arrived here on January 5th as they set up the screen to the near side. And that'll go for a first down. As Scarlett is tackled by Jordan Sherritt eventually. Appleby graduated in December from Purdue. Spent Christmas break with family who was placed down here in Florida. And then made his way over to Gainesville. And he's taken on a great attitude in the room. It was great at practice yesterday. You see the camaraderie between Del Rio and Appleby. Two guys competing for the same job, but really pushing each other.
They have a great relationship.
Here's Scarlett again, and tackled once again by Sherritt, the junior defensive end from Tampa. Alex McAllister off to try the NFL. Jonathan Bullard as well gone from that defensive line, but still a lot of athletic talent across the board for Florida.
Especially at the linebacker level. I mean, they are really, really good. Linebackers, secondary, they don't skip a beat. It's just replacing some of the talent and production up front. McAllister and Bullard were off the charts good last year.
Here's Appleby, play action with time, gonna take a shot downfield. And it was overthrown. The intended target was Josh Hammond. As a flag is down, Jalen Tabor had coverage.
I like the call right here, a little post move.
Pass interference, defense, number 31. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Tabor, the All-SEC selection last season.
And he got in front of the receiver and just tapped the brakes a little bit, which forced the receiver to slow down, draw contact, and the receiver's going to get that call every time. You see the play action right there. Nice pocket, good step up by Appleby, a nice high throw that gives his receiver the chance. And trying to hit Joshua Hammond right there, the freshman, who's been a guy that they feel can develop into a superstar. Quiet production over the course of the spring, but trying to get him involved early here in the Orange and Blue debut.
Hammond, one of those names we were just talking about on signing day, an ESPN 300 signee. So a first down out past midfield for Austin Appleby and this Orange team, as that was bottled up with ease. Scarlett taken down near the line of scrimmage that time. It was Joey Ivey, the big run-plugging defensive tackle, coming in.
Right here, you can see, I want you to look at these 5 big bodies up front along the offensive line. Last year, at this point, only six scholarship offensive linemen, could barely even field an offensive line. So it's a good situation along the offensive line when it comes to depth relative to where they were last year.
Kavanis Davis is still down at the end of that play. Defensive end from Miami. Coaches feel he's going to be an outstanding player before his career is finished.
Yeah, he was thrust in the last four games because of injury, so he's a guy that they expect to really take the next step this year after a full offseason of work.
Now, as they tend to Davis, we will take a short break here at the Orange and Blue debut. Good sign seeing Davis up on his feet. Stay with us, more to come. Joe Tessitore, Greg McElroy, Laura Rutledge with you here at the Orange and Blue debut, the Florida spring game, as we get our first extended look at Austin Appleby, the grad transfer from Purdue. And I liked what he said to us yesterday, Greg, when we met with him. He said, listen, I came here because I didn't want to look back at my college football career and say, I wish I would have. He wanted to know if he could compete at this level, go out and be at a championship level in the SEC, able to get that complete underneath the Josh Hammond who fights his way to the 35-yard line, and that's good for an Orange team first down.
They love his poise. They love his competitiveness. And I think they love the fact that he's now getting that second chance. As athletes, you always want that second chance, a new opportunity, a clean slate. Things didn't always go according to plan for Austin Appleby up at Purdue, but now here at the Gators, getting another shot at it and making the most of it here, really thick in this quarterback competition. A little adjustment in the spring game, a little audible, I like it.
And there had nowhere to go there as Jordan Scarlett was met right away by Kalen Johnson.
Kalen Johnson making the move from safety up into the linebacker spot. He kind of outgrew that safety spot, but they like his speed. They like the way he can run, and right there making a play in the backfield and forcing a second and long.
Play action now. Pressure on Appleby as he launches it downfield. And that was nearly intercepted by Marcus May trying to make a play on it. Josh Hammond was once again the intended target. Reminder, there's more spring football coming your way Saturday on the SEC ESPN Network. Interested to see what Will Muschamp's first spring game looks like with the Gamecocks. Going to be also a quarterback battle with A-Day at Jordan-Hare, Auburn's spring game, and then Texas A&M, new offensive coordinator for the Aggies. Quarterback battle as well down there at College Station. Full day of spring game action on the SEC ESPN Network. Third down run, bottled up at the line of scrimmage. Once again, Joey Ivey wrapping around Jordan Scarlett.
Now you see Pinero coming out, kicking a field goal. This is a luxury that they did not have last year. They ran the ball on third and 10 on their own 35. Last year, they're probably not going to make that field goal. They're probably looking at a punt. Now, with a big-legged kicker, they can easily make it from this distance.
A 53-yard attempt. Don't worry about distance with Eddie Pinero. He's the stuff of social media legend with a video of him kicking a 77-yard field goal online. Officially a 52-yard attempt for the new guy in town. You think he's got leg talent or what? Welcome to Gainesville, Eddie Pinero. Remember last year, Austin Harden was just 5 of 14. They were 10 of 17 overall. The JUCO transfer, the big recruit. Lake talent indeed. He's loving it. Florida's blue team starting quarterback Luke Del Rio has been well traveled in his football life. Of course, he moved 20 times as a kid because of his dad's job, Jack Del Rio, NFL head coach. And you see the road to arrive at Florida here. Start his career at Alabama, Greg.
Long road, but very much worth it. You can see backup in 2010, went on to Jacksonville, take him to the playoffs, only the fifth time in school history, and Right now, there's another team that I know of that's looking for a quarterback starting in 2010. Things didn't work out so well since that time for the Florida Gators at the quarterback. So the Florida Gators looking for a quarterback, Luke Del Rio looking for a home. They might have found each other here in Gainesville, and he's off to a fantastic start with two great throws early on a seam and a wheel route, one of which resulted in the touchdown.
There are no live kickoffs or punt returns here in the spring game. For more on Luke Del Rio, let's go down to the field to Laura Rutledge.
So, Tez, you can really tell just the comfortability factor between Doug Nussmeier and Luke Del Rio on the sideline watching them after that first possession. They're really talking to each other, talking through everything and smiling. It's very calm and relaxed. And then Del Rio showing some of the leadership that they've talked about, talking to Cronkright and Fullwood about the previous possession, also saying, hey, am I giving you guys enough? Do you need more from me? Asking his skill position players what else he can do for them. And Greg, that's got to be a good sign, right?
It is, and I think part of it, and Joe just alluded to it, he moved 20 times as a young man. He said, look, I can make friends very easily. I can communicate with anyone. Any walk of life, I'm going to be your buddy. And that's really helped in regards to his leadership, and the team's responded well to him so far.
He certainly seems to look to you.
Yeah, I think they respond well to anyone that's throwing dimes the way he is.
CJ Wharton with the reception here, Greg, and he has shown flashes this spring.
And this is going to be important right here, getting him outside the pocket, nice, accurate throw in the window, on time, under duress, probably going to take a hit there in a line game action, but Del Rio not showing any cobwebs, not a lot of experience at the college level, but certainly feels very comfortable within this Doug Nussmeier offense.
And in the backfield with Luke Del Rio is one of the guys I'm most curious to see this year in all of college football. That is Mark Thompson, the big guy, the JUCO transfer, 242 pounds, but that time met in the hole immediately by David Reese.
You can see Thompson. I mean, just looking at him. I mean, he looks like a defensive end. I mean, he's that big, and he's the first guy you want off the bus. He was a slot receiver in high school, kind of outgrew that position. They put him in the backfield. He's been explosive as a pass catcher and as a downhill runner. Now, he's had some issues fumbling the football this spring, but that's part of what he called a welcome to the SEC moment. He's getting it, though, and he's only going to be better when fall rolls around.
Second down run by Thompson as he spins his way to the 45. JUCO transfer was Thompson. Ran for nearly 1,300 yards and 18 rushing touchdowns in junior college.
And you can remember some of the JUCO guys in the SEC over the last couple years that have been exceptional. Cameron Artis Payne led the SEC in rushing at Auburn a couple years ago. Alvin Kamara burst onto the scene last year as the number two changeup back at Tennessee. So JUCO backs have come to this conference and excelled before, and Thompson might be the next.
It's Kerry Clark who's down at the end of that play. Let's check in with Laura.
You're talking about Mark Thompson, and it's been an interesting adjustment for him trying to play against this Florida defense in spring. And a situation early on in an early scrimmage where he was catching the ball out of the backfield, having a lot of success, and then he put the ball on the ground at the one-yard line, and he got a little concerned, but he was able to bounce back through encouragement from his teammates. These guys around him see how good he can be, and they want to keep telling him that. So he was able to bounce back from it, and they said from then on out, he's really looked good and shown a lot of flashes of what they think he can do in the SEC.
Of course, Laura, we were talking about a lot this week, the fact that they're replacing Kelvin Taylor. Do you see this as a running back by committee group, or do you think somebody emerges from that Florida running back depth chart as it stands right now?
In a perfect world, you'd try to get all four involved. In the real world, however, you're probably going to feed the hot hand. Kelvin Taylor last year accounted for 75% of the carries. And when you have a backfield that looks like this, where you have guys that do different things, that's only going to benefit and really lead you to the running back by committee of approach. But I would assume that the hot hand will have the ball in the fourth quarter. And right now, the way Mark Thompson's running it and his big body, he can lean on you in the fourth quarter, especially with the lead. So expect him to have a huge role this fall.
Third down and six. Del Rio complete again. Dre Massey, And that is a first down out near the 45, crossing midfield, and the crowd reacting well once again to Del Rio.
Third down was the Achilles heel of this team, especially in the last three games. They just couldn't stay on the field. Now Del Rio is doing a wonderful job staying within the offense. McElwain said, look, at times, yes, he's gotten a little cute. He's a coach's son. He probably knows more than he should. But at the same time, he's been effective. And when he allows the offense to work for him and he recognizes the playmakers that he has on the outside, he's been very, very effective. And it's a big reason why he's leading this quarterback derby right now.
Sophomore who grew up around the game. He's got those competitive juices. Coach Nussmeier quick to point out how much his teammates enjoy his company. Pressure came off the edge that time, so he just burned it to the outside as Christian Garcia was running in free.
That right there might be his best play of the day so far.
Understood.
I mean,
sure,
throwing it away, you look at it, okay, you're on the plus side of the 50. Let's live to play second and 10. Let's not try to avoid on the outside, and then you're looking at a sack. So sometimes throwaways are the best play, and I'm not kidding, Joe. I really think that's the best play he's had all game.
In a very strong first quarter here at the Florida Spring game, Luke Del Rio 4 for 5, a touchdown pass to get the night going for Coach Mack's offense.
All right, Luke, hey, we're going in now. We're going to break orange and blue, you got me? Get into your spots, all right? Make sure you're getting yourself mentally ready to be proud of what you put on film, you got it? All right, have it up, we'll take it in, have it up. Hey, Austin, make sure you're looking. If there's no depth in that defense over here, you're looking that 5x5 first.
Think we had him?
Well, you came awful quick to the backside post.
Hands-on coaching of Jim McElwain to start the second quarter here in the Florida Spring game. Glad you're with us. Joe, Greg, and Laura. Blue team on the field with a 7-3 lead. Luke Del Rio at quarterback. Running back screen, Mark Thompson. As he utilizes his blockers, good balance to stay on his feet. As he was eventually met by Chris Williamson. Interesting to hear Coach McElwain in the midst of gameplay talking about be proud of what you put on tape. I think they're going to be fairly pleased with what's on tape so far tonight with both quarterbacks we've seen so far, Luke Del Rio and Austin Appleby. Some good decision making.
I think he always talks about your brand. Your brand. You represent yourself, your family, your name. Every time you step out there on the field, the name on the jersey, on the back, it'll tell the story. How much effort do you give? What type of performance do you have? He's always preaching that. I think it's resonating with these players.
Here's Del Rio to pass on first down. And he checks underneath to Thompson. As he is tough to take down, finally wrestled by David Reese and Marcel Harris.
Had a tough time juking the umpire right there. Good job checking it down, though, right there. You know, I love when quarterbacks utilize their running backs in the passing game. That's the best ball carrier on the field. It's the shortest throw, the easiest throw on the field. Give it to him. Taking the check down is not a sign of weakness. Right there, Luke Del Rio going through the progression, not liking anything downfield, and giving it to his 6'3", 242-pound monster over the middle. Now you're looking at a second and short.
And Thompson will carry it on second and three, and wide open into the end zone. Plenty of green grass once he made the cut to the outside. A touchdown for the JUCO transfer, Mark Thompson. Well-managed drive again by Luke Del Rio. 26-yard touchdown run by Thompson.
Look at the gash up front. Look at the offensive line. Obviously, you see 97, Justice Reed unblocked. Mark Thompson sees him, gives a little jump cut to the outside. That's a big body that you're forcing a miss. That's really well done right there. Obviously, Mark Thompson, first spring in this offense. He's only going to get better right there, having the patience and wherewithal in the hole to adjust, break it to the outside, and turn on the accelerators. And once he gets going, Joe, he's tough to bring down and he's tough to catch.
Panero tacks on the extra point. Also picked up a good block there by Chris Thompson, a wide receiver. But the 242-pound Mark Thompson with a touchdown run here. Del Rio, two drives, two touchdown drives so far tonight. Of course, it has been choppy waters in the post-Timmy era since 2009 after Tebow. Look at some of the combinations of Florida quarterbacks, but specifically, look at the rankings, the passing rankings nationally over that span, Greg.
Yeah, and obviously 2011 and 12 and 13, having two different coordinators over that time span at Brent Pease and Charlie Weiss, that makes it a little difficult. 2010, the last year of the Urban Meyer era, there's been a lot of turnover. 2015, of course, Will Grier getting off to a great start, six games in. Clearly the suspension led to Treon Harris taking over. They just have not had stability at the position. And it's the most important position in college football. It's tough to win without them, and Florida has been up and down as a result of their quarterback play.
Grier started the first six games last year for Florida, had success, then the NCAA penalty came down on him. He just recently announced that he'll be transferring to West Virginia. Treon Harris started eight games last year. The offense really sputtered down the stretch. He is indefinitely suspended, has not been with the team this semester. That is a school university student code of conduct issue, as Coach McElwain told us yesterday, in terms of Treon Harris, and more specifically Antonio Callaway, in terms of making an impact this year. That is a wait and see. They will find out when those players can return, if they are available to the Gators. Mark Herndon now in at running back with Austin Appleby and that orange offense. They had a 52-yard field goal on their first drive. Here's Appleby as he goes underneath and is able to find Josh Hammond. Mentioned Antonio Callaway. He's been absent this semester. He was one of the real breakout stars for Florida a year ago. Suspended indefinitely. Had the 64-yard touchdown catch and run to beat Tennessee, but has not been with the team since January. Good inside run from Mark Herndon. He has had an outstanding spring. A former walk-on who earned a scholarship, tore his ACL in 2014, was never able to really contribute much a year ago, but come this spring now healthy, he has been outstanding.
Now, I know coaches say, look, picking your favorite player is like picking your favorite child. It's impossible to do, but I'm telling you, I think Jim McElwain's favorite player on this team is Mark Herndon. Former walk-on, got a scholarship a couple of years ago. The guy loves the game. He's enthusiastic, and every single person in the huddle rallies when he's in there.
So Herndon's big run crosses midfield. First down for Austin Appleby in the orange offense at the 45. Wide receiver screen this time to Hammond, unable to elude Quincy Wilson, the starting cornerback replacing Vernon Hargraves on this defense. Good combination with Wilson on one side, Tabor on the other.
I think Wilson is going to be a star. I mean, Tabor, of course, is going to get a lot of the headlines, a lot of the press. But if you look at Quincy Wilson, you look at how physical he is. He's willing to play at the line of scrimmage. He's outstanding in space, just like he showed right there when it came to tackling. This is a 1-2 punch that certainly will carry on the tradition that Florida Gators like to refer to as DBU.
To make a strong argument, being the most talented group in the country in recent years. Alvin Bailey on the inside tunnel screen to the 41-yard line, met by Jared Davis, the senior linebacker.
Davis looks good. I mean, he's not the biggest guy in the world, and he's not going to blow you away physically, but he reminds me a little bit of C.J. Mosley at Alabama a couple years ago. Very athletic, can run extremely well sideline to sideline, and he's such a hard worker. He's gained 10 pounds of good weight this offseason, and for a guy that really was unbelievable in production last year, I think most people are excited to see what he's capable of doing as an encore, as a senior.
Herndon's in the slot here for this third and six. They bring four against Appleby, and he chooses to run it and does so with success.
No,
as they will mark him down.
They're not going to give him the first down.
They're not going to give him the first down there, Greg.
Oh, come on.
Obviously, quarterback's not going to take a hit, but it looked like he was past the point of where he would have been tackled.
Austin here, Appleby, 6'4", 235. You think right here, Jordan
right Sherrod,
yeah, he's going to give him a – he's going to tackle him.
But it's a first down.
But he's going to fall forward at 235, that type of momentum. Look, I don't want to see quarterbacks taking hits, but I also don't want to see them losing yards as a result of having that white jersey on. Maybe I'm a quarterback homer.
Well, I know how much pride you take in Coach McElwain seeing a running quarterback. I think he gave you one read option back in the day when he was your play caller, and you actually made the most of it.
If I'm going to pull it from Mark Ingram, you better make the most of it.
So it's a 4th-and-3 here after that spot of the quarterback run of Appleby. Appleby to pass, and it is complete, and inside the 30-yard line of Freddie Swain, and that will be a first down for the Orange offense, converting the 4th-and-3.
Yeah, nice job right there by Swain, being patient, not running out of bounds too quickly. Sometimes on those rollout routes, they take a little bit longer to develop. Freddie Swain, an early enrollee freshman, already comfortable within the offense, recognizing the tempo and not getting himself in trouble by getting too close to the sideline. Nice job by the freshman.
A nice job by Austin Appleby, grad transfer quarterback. He's in the competition against Luke Del Rio to see who will be the starter here for the Gators. Run goes nowhere that time as Kylan Johnson came up to meet Herndon.
This Orange team has moved the ball pretty well, this offense. Obviously, their first drive stalled but resulted in 3 points because they have a kicker with a massive leg. They're going against maybe one of the top defenses in the country, and for the most part, this Orange group is made up of backups or guys that will be filling in the depth of their various offensive positions. So pretty good job by Austin Appleby and company so far, moving it against a very talented group.
2nd and 11 now. Appleby, dangerous, trying to set up the screen that time to Herndon as Tabor came in and blew it up.
Great read by Jalen Tabor right here. They have a new defensive back coach in Torian Gray, and they're trying to train Jalen Tabor to recognize tendencies in offensive formations. He relies so much on physical ability, he thinks that he can really improve and take the next step by improving the mental side of the game. Right there, saw the back coming out of the backfield, jumped on it, and forced an incompletion. Well done by the junior, one of the top corners in the country.
He's really made a commitment to step up as a leader on this defense as well. 3rd down and 11 now. Pressure on Appleby. Steps up, and they're going to whistle this one. And that is a proper mark. That
was the right spot, yes. That one I will not complain about.
So once again, we will see Eddie Pinero, the JUCO transfer kicker, hit the 52-yarder earlier tonight. This will be held at the 36-yard line.
Such a nice luxury to have, a kicker that you can rely on.
46-yard attempt for Pinero. And once again, he drives it through. Some say maybe the biggest change to this Florida team, having the reliable leg of Eddie Pinero. 52-yarder and now a 46-yarder. As the Orange team has 2 field goals on the board. Also streaming live on Watch ESPN. That's baseball doubleheader Sunday afternoon on the SEC ESPN network.
Conference is rocking and rolling on the diamond this year, are they not, Joe? Goodness. Not that they ever aren't. This is a really good league for baseball.
14-6 here in the Florida spring game. We mentioned earlier that Antonio Callaway has been absent this semester with his indefinite suspension, but an opportunity for another wide receiver then to step up for him.
Yeah, Joe, and it's a situation where Ahmad Fullwood's been waiting in the wings for a while. He's been ready to go, but Jim McElwain keeps telling him, hey, stop playing like you're 5'5", play more like you're 6'3", which is his actual height. And he said, these 3 years have gone by fast. He's ready to step up. He said he's not going to take no for an answer. He's going to go up and get balls and really play to his size. Another thing, though, guys, he thinks the real secret is he's been carrying around a gallon of water everywhere, and he's staying hydrated. He thinks it's making a big difference. So on that note, I hope you guys are staying hydrated up there.
Well, you know, in the movie Space Jam, the special juice was water, was it not? Worked out for the Toon Squad. Maybe water is the secret ingredient, Joe.
Well, Fullwood's had a nice spring. I guess the hydration has worked out well. Well, they have a good group of young, talented receivers who have come into this program as well.
Fullwood's a guy, I mean, he's just so big and strong and physical. He's got to be a feature player in this offense. He just has too much talent not to be.
Austin Appleby stays in the game here with the blue squad as he was sacked that time. Wide receiver conversation starts with Fullwood. Dre Massey is a JUCO transfer. Swain and Hammond, early enrollees. And keep in mind, Brandon Powell had off-season foot surgery. But he's one of the few experienced and proven playmakers who undoubtedly will contribute to that group come fall camp.
Compared to where this group was a year ago, it's amazing how much more talented and how much deeper they are. They have some legitimate weapons on the outside. The three new and early enrollees, particularly Dre Massey, has been a very welcome sign of explosiveness. They're excited about this group.
Appleby on third and 10, and once again, he is sacked. As Jabari Zuniga was quick to get in.
Zuniga's had a really, really good spring. You look at the anticipation, the jump by Luke Ankrum in front of by the D-tackle number 98, and outside, Jabari Zuniga. The freshman, 6'3", 240. This team needs to find that elite pass rusher. They had McAllister and Bullard a year ago. They think Zuniga could potentially fill that void if he continues to develop and put in the work in this summer.
So our first look at Johnny Townsend, outstanding junior punter. No returns are live in the spring game as Townsend drives it down to the 31-yard line. Just over a minute and a half to go in this first half. Been entertaining so far from Gainesville with our quarterback battle underway. Stay with us. Last year was Florida's first SEC East title in 6 years. You see the stretch since 2010 onward. Coach McElwain just the third head coach to make it to the SEC championship game in his first year at an SEC school. Defensive line getting the best of the young Felipe Franks, the 6'6". True freshman, early enrollee, who in recent years was one of the most talked about recruits. Very tall, strong arms, got huge upside.
Yeah, he can really rip the football. Now his release is a little bit long. They're going to have to tighten that up and shorten it up because there are some defensive backs that are capable of driving on it. But
is that part of his baseball background?
I think that is the baseball background, without question. Probably an outfielder at some point or another.
So Felipe Franks getting his first action as Herndon is bobbled up at the 32-yard line. Jared Davis again with the tackle, leader of that defense among the linebackers.
Back to Franks. I think one thing that's going to be important for him is to recognize when to cut your losses. He's made some mistakes over the last couple days watching him. Even that first play, yes, he was sacked, but he threw it a little carelessly. It resulted in an interception. Now, the play was dead, but you have to be smarter with the football. And for a freshman, look, it's tough because he was the best player on the field at the high school level. It's not the case now. He's going to have to learn how to play within the system.
And being the best player on the field as a quarterback at the high school level is often just that first look. As it is picked off, intercepted by Duke Dawson, and down to the 20-yard line. So Felipe Franks out on the field and throws an interception as Dawson takes advantage of the young gun.
And right here, he just stares it down. I mean, look at the eyes, looks off it, back to it. And Duke Dawson's a veteran player. He's played a lot of football, been very explosive. The junior, 5'10", 202. And right there, that's just, look, it's okay. These things will happen. Now I want to see what Felipe Franks does next. You're going to make mistakes as a young player. Rip off the rearview mirror. Recognize that it's in the past. There's nothing you can do about it now, and come out in the second half and do your very best to make sure that you right the wrong.
You know, we just had that conversation about what it looks like in high school ball. He should still be in high school getting ready for his prom. Laura's down on the field with Coach Mack. Laura.
Thanks, Joe. And Coach, you were able to get some good playing time for your quarterbacks, Del Rio, Appleby, and also Franks. What's your impression so far?
Well, I thought Luke handled it pretty well when he came in, and I was really impressed with Austin, the way he took that offense and went and put some points on the board. That's a good thing. Now, these last couple drives, you know, we're going to have to get that corrected, unacceptable, and you know, poor Felipe, you know, first play we calls a bomb. You know, the guy, at least let him hand one off in the swamp, maybe, huh?
I like that. So, Eddie Pinheiro, you wanted to get him under some bright lights and see how he handled the pressure. What can you say about his leg talent?
Well, I mean, he's everything that's advertised. I was most excited about the fact that he got his helmet on right and he was able to buckle his chin strap. I was excited about that.
He looks like a football player so far, right?
Yeah, you know, that's pretty good, isn't it?
Thank you.
You bet.
Having a little fun with Pinheiro playing in his first college football action in front of a crowd. He delivered for the Orange team, a 52-yarder and a 46-yarder, but it was Luke Del Rio. 105 yards, 6 of 7, a touchdown, and a 14-6 lead for the blue team. More to come. Stay with us. Glad you're with us for the orange and blue debut here, the Florida spring game. The blue team with a 14-6 lead, thanks to quarterback Luke Del Rio. Luke Del Rio and Austin Appleby looking pretty good in the first half here in Gainesville. Of course, the current quarterback competition, that has been the big story in spring football. And a big part of our recent all-access visit with the Gators, Maria Taylor and former Gator great Chris Doering take us closer.
At the University of Florida, great quarterback play is expected from every Gator fan. That's because there are three Heisman Trophy winners and all played the quarterback position, the last winning the trophy in 2007, and his name was Tim Tebow. Maria Taylor, alongside Chris Doering, who is a former Florida great, who played wide receiver here. You played with some great quarterbacks. Yeah. You know what it takes to be successful in the SEC. But right now, Florida has a quarterback competition raging. Four guys competing for the position. And what have you seen out of the competition and expect to see from these players?
Well, I think the thing that I've seen the most is the competition. All of those guys competing with one another has elevated the overall talent of that group. I think when you come down to it, though, four of those guys are really going to be minimized to two. Austin Appleby, the transfer from Purdue, and obviously Luke Del Rio, a guy that's been on the roster the longest. In fact, some people talked last year, had Luke Del Rio been given that waiver to play right away, he could have been the starter last season. So I think there's a lot of expectation, even though none of those guys have played yet here at Florida. I think this is the two guys we'll be looking at as this competition wears on.
Yes, and Jim McElwain looking for his starter. We had a chance to talk to him and some of the front runners in the quarterback competition.
We've got some guys battling out this spring, and it's been really fun. It's great to see the camaraderie within the room, and yet the competition's been outstanding, and I think that's helped our whole team.
That's it, Luke. That a way to work.
When I was in Colorado, Coach Mack offered me. It's my first offer at Colorado State, and when I talked to Coach Mack and Coach Nuss about what they wanted to do, it was very similar to what they had been doing.
It was a great 4 years at Purdue. I graduated, and it was time to move on, have an opportunity to compete for a championship and play at the next level. And, you know, this place has been a dream come true for me. It was my dream school. Have such an opportunity.
I should see your mind and your feet work. You should be set and ready to throw that no matter what. Better job with our feet now. You should be sitting right there. Where's my action? Bam!
To come to a place like this and have an opportunity to compete with some great quarterbacks and be a part of such a great program, you know, it comes with a lot.
I think that position needs to be earned. And, you know, you want to step up, you want to lead the offense. I know that I'm going to have to earn it first, but when I'm in there, I definitely try to command.
There you go, Luke. Attaboy. Get that one under. Get that. There you go.
Putting in the time and working at your craft and trying to become a master of your craft, and that's all you can do.
We've got an opportunity to do something very, very special here. And we'll go as the quarterback goes. It's nothing that we're going to shy away from. We understand what this position's been.
You know, I'm going to do everything in my power to be the one that's under center. It's up to the coaches in the end, but I think we'll definitely be dynamic.
Practice is one thing, but once you're out there, it's a whole new animal. And I think I bring that level of poise, that level of confidence, the level of preparation. I just got to do my job.
We got to hear from Austin and Luke, and what do you think that both of those guys bring to the quarterback competition?
I think they bring a little something different. And Austin Appleby, even though he hasn't played here at Florida, he's played some significant games at Purdue, so you bring a guy with some experience in, a leadership aspect to that quarterback position. And then also when you talk about Luke Del Rio, this guy was in the offense for the entire year last year, so I think you're thinking about a guy that may not have played but has been brought along, has learned from some of the mistakes last year, and now has the capability of taking on a lot more as he moves into that potential starting position.
Well, you know, Chris, Florida hasn't had a total QBR that ranked in the top half of the SEC since 2009. They're looking to change that when they find their brand new starter here in Gainesville.
And that quarterback will be their ninth starting quarterback since Tim Tebow. Luke Del Rio looking good tonight. 105 yards, touchdown pass, blew up 14-6. More from the Florida Spring Game presented by Regions Bank when we return. McElroy Rutledge here at the Swamp. The blue team with a 14-6 lead and a smile on the face of Coach Mack with his quarterback play.
A little breeze in his face. High snap, get in there. Hey, Austin, be prepared to step up, right, with that edge pressure. Just make sure you're take your open chinks every time, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Gotcha.
I like the idea of the shot. Everything's good. Just go get us some points.
Gotcha.
Okay?
Austin Appleby got his team some points, and this guy got himself some more defensive stats. Jared Davis with 6 total tackles, Laura. Jared Davis continues his defensive leadership. Laura, of course, they're going to be banking on him to continue that right through the fall.
Exactly right, Joe, and it's a situation where Jared really felt like he needed to take this year as an opportunity to step up. He had a conversation with his mom, Amy, the other day, and they talked about that. She was saying, look, you can't take any plays off. He said, I know. And he's really made a commitment to making sure he doesn't have a bad read. He doesn't miss a tackle. He said, when he gets out there, it's my field. He wants to take ownership of every single thing. A big part of that has been blocking out some of the distraction, a lot of the talk and hype around him this year. He said he'll just leave his cell phone in the training room all day long, so he doesn't even look at it. He doesn't even bother with it. So I guess if you're trying to contact Jared Davis and he doesn't respond to your text, you know why now.
Well, Laura, I think he's going to like responding to this as well as his blue defensive teammates as the fresh meat of Felipe Franks, the early and lowly true freshman, is back out there as he hands off to Scarlett, who tries to wiggle his way free, fighting off would-be tacklers right at the line of scrimmage before he's eventually taken down. Franks was thrown into the fire pretty solid there, wasn't he, Greg, before half?
Yeah, it's not an easy situation. You're standing around for an hour, not throwing a lot of balls, not throwing any routes. And then sure enough, here, go ahead, kid, 18 years old, should be prepping for his high school prom. Instead, he's here at the Orange and Blue debut and got thrown right into the fire of a 2-minute drive. But let's see how he bounces back. You're going to make mistakes as a freshman. That's expected. There's nothing wrong with that. It's all about how you respond.
One of the most talented prep quarterbacks in recent years. Everybody was going after him. Florida able to land him. An early enrollee here at 6'6", loaded with arm talent. 2nd and 10. As he's able to get it out of the backfield that time to Cameron Knight. As Knight is brought down at the 29-yard line by Jared Davis again. His 7th tackle of the evening. It'll be 3rd down and about 6.
Going back to Jared Davis, what I like most about him is he plays the game with a chip on his shoulder. I mean, he's a guy that came in the 2013 recruiting class. There were 4 linebackers that were signed in that group, and he was the lowest rated of all 4, and he's by far and away the best of all 4 now. He plays the game with a real chip on his shoulder, and he's definitely the leader of this defense.
Felipe Franks, 2nd interception of the night thrown. As Franks with a rough night, Johnson with the pick, and you see Johnson showing up on the linebacker depth chart for the Gators.
Yeah, he's used to catching passes. Former safety, converted to linebacker, gives the position an awful lot of speed. You see those 3 guys along the left. All 3 of those guys were included in that 2013 class that I just alluded to. Matt Rowland was another guy, committed to South Carolina, flipped late, came to Florida. You see him chalking it up right there. Interception.
Well, they take a lot of pride on that turnover board, don't they?
They do, and you can see it right here. Look, this is a bad play. There's nothing there. Don't make it worse, and he'll learn that. And you just can't be careless with the football. There are no wasted downs. Every single play has a purpose. And you just can't make it worse. Those are the things that will frustrate you if you're a coach. But like I said, this is a young man that should be in high school. He's going to grow. He's going to develop. And he's going to get better.
Luke Del Rio can't get much better than the way he's playing tonight. Chris Thompson, as he is taken down at about the 6-yard line as the blue team took over with prime field position. And Thompson takes it to a first and goal situation for the blue team, already up 14-6. Mark Thompson in at running back.
That Chris Thompson right there, the receiver that just caught the ball, he's the fastest guy in the group, and you saw the burst up field. They really like what he's capable of. You just can't teach speed, and he's got plenty of it. 85 for the blue at the bottom right here.
Mark Thompson tried to bounce that, lost the ball. Ball was fumbled. And we will see who comes up with it. It's picked up and advanced that time by C.J. Wharton. I mean, he just ended up in the right place and took advantage. What an oddity. But C.J. Wharton's not going to complain. Score it for the blue team.
Maybe one of the more unusual touchdowns C.J. Wharton, the junior receiver, will ever have. Look, this is all on Mark Thompson. I mean, he has struggled with fumbles over the course of the spring. He said that's been the toughest transition from junior college to the SEC. He's going to have to get better. He's done it twice now, once in the scrimmage last week inside the red zone, now again here in the orange and blue game. Heads-up play by C.J. Wharton, though, being around the pile and jumping on it and not going down on first touch.
Yeah, he won't get talked about much, but what a great job by Christian Garcia, the linebacker for the orange team, coming through against the grain, finding Mark Thompson and jarring that ball loose to force the fumble. But the bounce goes C.J. Wharton's way. And after the turnover, the interception thrown by Felipe Franks, the blue team takes advantage of a 21-6 lead. A year ago, it was a good start until they hit LSU. Will Greer suspended. Treon Harris had a start at quarterback. From there on out, the offense really sputtered down the stretch. Barely got past FAU. Only had the safety against Florida State. Defense played well enough in the SEC championship game, but gave way to Alabama, and then things really bottomed out in the postseason. Coach McElwain was quick to give an explanation, at least what he theorizes as to why that bowl result happened.
Obviously, the SEC championship game was instituted in 1992. Last year's senior crop of Florida Gators were the first group in school history that had never been to the SEC championship game. Once they got the win against Vanderbilt, that secured their spot in Atlanta. The level of urgency, the execution, the passion, the chip on their shoulder was lacking after that game. They weren't for a lack of talent, they were for a lack of focus. This group now feels as though they have something to prove. They came up short last year. This year they're looking forward to leaving their mark.
And someone to find as the starting quarterback, as we see the fourth candidate, Kyle Trask, the other true freshman, early enrollee, 6'4", 227 from Manville, Texas. As he hands off to Herndon, and Herndon goes for 2 yards. Kyle Trask, in all my years of covering college football, Greg, and I think you'd agree, is probably one of the most curious tales of recruiting you will ever find. He was not the starting quarterback at his own high school team, yet he was very well regarded, an early enrollee who they love down here at Florida.
He was at Manville High School in Texas, was probably going to be the starter as a sophomore, got hurt. They put in a guy that was an exceptional athlete, got recruited, ended up at TCU, Joe.
Derek King, exceptional athlete, one of the top 15 all-around athletes in this past recruiting class.
Probably going to be a slot receiver for the Horned Frogs. Trask just never had his opportunity, but in mop-up time, he was unbelievable. He came to camp, and Doug Nussmeier and Jim McElwain saw him throw. They're like, who's this guy? What's the story? They, of course, had some reserves saying, well, he never played in high school. What's the deal? What's the problem? Surely there's a knock. This is a guy's a 4.0 GPA, does everything the right way, an unbelievable competitor, knew that Felipe Franks was a five-star quarterback, said he didn't care, wanted a chance to come and compete. He throws a great ball, very talented, and I think if he's given some opportunities, which he's never had before, they believe he can develop into a star at this level.
Wasn't the starting quarterback on his own high school team and competing to be the starter here at Florida. Kyle Trask, third down and eight. And there's a look at his accuracy out to midfield as he gets it complete to Alvin Bailey. First completion as a Florida Gator in front of the home crowd for Kyle Trask.
I mean, what a great throw. I mean, look at this. Little switch combination, four vertical against man off his back foot. That's exactly where you want it, 18 yards on the hash. Look at the fundamentals, though. Nice feet underneath them, nice high release, good spiral, very catchable football. Kyle Trask, although a little underrated coming out of high school, I think for the wrong reasons, this guy can flat out play.
For more on Kyle Trask, let's check in with Laura.
Well, his other teammates have certainly taken notice of this talent from Trask, you guys, and a situation where Ahmad Fullwood and a few other guys I talked to said, look, he throws one of the prettiest balls we've seen, and he's so accurate, he puts it right on the money, and just for his age, he has a great sense about where the ball should be going, and they've really enjoyed that working with him this spring.
Trask with the completion out to midfield, now facing a second and long here. With that orange team, his first action of the night. Felipe Franks, the other true freshman early enrollee, has thrown two interceptions so far. Trask trying to extend the play, and then the whistle comes in as it was Johnson coming in on Trask.
Yeah, right now, Trask just a little bit ahead of Felipe Franks from a football IQ standpoint. Right there outside the pocket, very smartly throwing it away. Felipe Franks has had two sacks and two late throwaways, one which resulted in an interception. The other was picked off but blown dead before the ball was released. So right now, Kyle Trask just a little ahead of Franks, but it's going to be an interesting competition to watch between these two as they continue their college careers.
It's almost as if we're having two separate quarterback competitions under the umbrella of these four who are in the quarterback room. You got the more veteran guys, Del Rio and Appleby, and then the early enrollees, Franks and now Trask. Here's a third and 10 for Kyle Trask. And utilizing the legs as they will whistle him down at the 40-yard line. Johnson once again pursuing.
This ought to be interesting right here. Ball on the 40-yard line. You got fourth and one. You have a big-legged kicker. And you have an opportunity on short yardage to potentially convert. So definitely options that they did not have in 2013. Looks like they're going to keep the offense out there, and why not? Spring scrimmage, let them compete.
Mark Herndon, who has worked his way back well from the torn ACL in 2014. The running back here on fourth and one as Trask is out of the gun. Fourth down and one for the orange team. And Herndon, a little bit of extra leg drive that time as he will move the chains. David Reese, the first to get involved and meet him.
This play
so
right
first
here.
First down for the orange team.
This play right here is a bread and butter play. One back power. This is just what you want. Down, down. You see the pulling guard, number 68, getting around it. Herndon doing a nice job keeping his legs going, getting just enough of the first down. Fresh set here for the freshman Kyle Trask in the orange offense.
Richard Desert Jones, the guard there on the power play. Ninth play of this drive as Herndon that time was met at the line of scrimmage. It was both Reese and Johnson combining for the tackle. You know, you brought it up earlier about the coaches when they were in the recruiting process of getting after Kyle Trask and saying, all right, what's wrong? What's the red flag? Are we missing something? The kid doesn't start at his own high school. He's an Eagle Scout. He's a 4.0 student. He's everything that he's cooked up to be. And they had the opportunity to see him here at their camp. That was the big reveal. They put him with elite talent when he was here, so the speed of the game proving it wasn't too much for him.
I was in a similar situation coming out of high school. I only started 1 year as a high school senior, backed up a very good player, Chase Daniel, now with the Philadelphia Eagles. So I had to go on the camp circuit as well. Kyle Trask, when going up against top-level competition, guys that might have been a little more highly regarded, he allowed the competitive juices to get going. And he threw it better than they did. They couldn't find a flaw.
I'll tell you, he's showing you some glimpses of athleticism here at 6'4", 227.
Well, he's a big body. And look, they said, honestly, guys, when you see him, you're going to say he looks like he's 12 years old. He can still develop so much. He has exactly what you want, but he's a pot of clay. They can mold him and develop him and allow his body to mature. But he is a better athlete than you would probably assume, given his size.
Third down and three. Remember, they converted the fourth and one moments ago. Keep this drive alive. Herndon remains the lone back for Trask and this Orange offense. And a ball comes loose that time, but it is out of bounds. Flag is down at the 38-yard line as Chris Williamson came up to make that hit. So that'll bring up a fourth down. And perhaps that means we see once again the big leg of Eddie Pinero. We told you on social media, online, the stuff of legend. 77-yarder he made. That was the buzz of the specialist circuits. All those Jamie Cole camps, Alabama offered him. He was a verbal there, flipped to Florida. 52-yarder, 46-yarder, and can he now hit a 54-yarder. And that time, it leaked over to the right. But still, you get a sense of the power and the ability of Eddie Pinero, Coach Mack Willing. Fun night here in Gainesville. More to come. 21-6, Blue on top. Throughout the day tomorrow, big weekend of baseball throughout the conference. And this is a group that definitely is going to play a major role in Florida's success this coming season, Greg.
The only group on the team with a new position coach as well. Taurean Gray, coming down from Virginia Tech, spent the last 10 years there, had 5 All-Americans, 10 draftees. He's got a talented group to work with.
There's a talented back in Mark Thompson. Of course, Duke Dawson had an interception tonight off of Felipe Franks. He is part of that veteran group, Tabor, Marcus May, Duke Dawson, but young talent throughout that secondary as well.
What makes this secondary very unique is every single player in the secondary can, in theory, play another position within the secondary. You can put Tabor at safety and Dawson at corner and Wilson at safety and Washington at corner. You can move guys around, which makes it very difficult as an offensive mind as you try to prepare for blitzes and tendencies and adjustments like that. These are interchangeable pieces, and they are supremely talented.
Luke Del Rio back out there with the blue offense. Keep in mind, you lose Keanu Neal and Vernon Hargraves, guys that are going to be cashing NFL paychecks, and you still say those things about the Florida defensive backs. This is Ciante Lewis, a very good-looking fluid athlete playing tight end.
This is a guy they have high hope. For. I mean, Ciante Lewis last year really got off to a great start, had flashes, then he hurt his hand, kind of disappeared, missed 5 games. This is a high school basketball player that has an awful lot of upside. You and me looked at him yesterday, Joe, at practice and said, my goodness, let's get the ball to 80 early and often. Expect him to be featured. This is an offense now that uses 2 tight end sets 40% of the time. That's Jim McElwain's staple. So Lewis, Knight, Stevens, Goolsby, all those guys should be heavily involved in the rotation.
First down. Out of the backfield comes Thompson again. As we've got a good look at Mark Thompson tonight. So that's the end of the third quarter. The blue team on the march again here. Luke Del Rio has been hot. Over 150 yards passing, that touchdown pass, his team leads 21-6. a Regions Bank. Good crowd here. Under the lights, Laura. Novel concept, isn't it? Works.
We love it under the lights, and thanks, Joe. Coach, let's go back to C.J. Wharton's touchdown. He made a heads-up play to take an opportunity there. What'd you see on that?
Well, here's a good thing. Based on the end of last season, we'd do anything to score, so it was a heck of a deal. But disappointing in the ball security piece of it, and yet guys were scrapping around, and that's what it's all about.
What are you looking for as we head into this final fourth quarter? What do you still need to see?
Well, you know, I'd like to see our backs kind of take control of it a little bit and yet continue to just keep taking what they give us. And I think for the most part, the quarterbacks are doing that.
All right. Thank you, Coach. Swamp night.
Thanks.
Now, the back who's out on the field right now for that blue team is Mark Thompson, who has 46 yards and a touchdown on the ground. Also has three catches for 25 yards. Of course, the big story with Florida this spring, the quarterback competition. We've seen the two more veteran guys, Del Rio and Appleby. I think both guys have managed things well. Franks, the two interceptions, and Kyle Trask had a decent-looking drive in the third quarter.
Like you talked about, Joe, it's Del Rio and Appleby at this point. Franks and Trask are battling for that third spot, so it's going to be very interesting. We still have in the entire fourth quarter and some overtime simulated periods here at the end, so we might be able to separate those guys a little bit more here in a few minutes.
Del Rio, good look, and a touchdown pass to Dre Massey. Boy, oh boy, I think there's going to be some buzz about Mr. Del Rio, isn't there, Greg?
That's a dime right there. On time, deliberate, right on the face mask, and to a target that this Florida coaching staff is very excited about. Dre Massey has provided a lot of oohs and ahs over the course of the spring. Off to a nice start here, and this is Florida Gator, his first spring here in Gainesville. Look at it right here. Look at Del Rio. Work his eyes. Eyes down the middle. Look at that stripe. Held the free safety. Knows he has a chance, a window that's going to be wide open. You have a receiver up against a linebacker, and that's a mismatch all day and tomorrow. Take it and leave it. Touchdown, Gators.
The well-traveled Luke Del Rio. Jack Del Rio's son, who started his college football career as a walk-on at Alabama. That's when his current offensive coordinator, Doug Nussmeier here in Florida, was there in Tuscaloosa. Nussmeier moved on. Del Rio moved on. Went to Oregon State. Played in only three games there. Made his way here to Florida. You know, you see the photos with Dad. Remember, of course, was head coach at Jacksonville Jaguars. So he actually grew up about an hour away, but then the journey moved on, Greg.
Yeah, and it wasn't necessarily always for greener pastures. It's not because he was buried on the depth chart. He was the backup at Oregon State. It was because the coaching staff changed. Doug Nussmeier, no longer the OC at Alabama after 2013. He felt like he needed to go elsewhere. Went to Oregon State, a place that offered him coming out of high school. Coaching staff changed. Mike Riley moves on to Nebraska. He comes here to Florida, where there's stability in place, and now has an opportunity to be the starter. And with a 10 of 11 performance, we're a buck 76 and a couple tuds, I'd say he's off to a really good start here under the lights in the Swamp.
You know, and Luke said, you point out all the coaching changes and the different circumstances to arrive at this. He said, listen, I didn't think I'd go to three colleges, but not everyone's journey is the same. Well, this journey may end up in a very good place based on the way he looks tonight. Of course, things will have to get to fall camp where Del Rio and Appleby and then a further matured Felipe Franks and Kyle Trask will all arrive to get ready for the fall season.
There's a lot of transfer quarterbacks that have had success in this conference. I mean, when you look at some of the names, guys that have recently affected the SEC, there's been Chad Kelly, who came from Clemson to Ole Miss. Obviously, Jake Coker from Florida State to Alabama. Ryan Mallett, a few years back, started his career at Michigan, finished up as a record-setting quarterback at Arkansas. Who can forget the NFL's most valuable player, Cam Newton? Both Coker and Cam, both national champions. So with Appleby and Del Rio, we might have another transfer quarterback to add to that list. And who can forget, Joe? I know things didn't always go according to plan with Austin Appleby at Purdue. Sometimes a fresh start's all you need. Florida fans, remember this name, Jeff Driscoll. Last year, he threw for 4,000 yards and 27 touchdowns at Louisiana Tech. Maybe a fresh start's all these guys need.
The tackle moments ago by Chris Williamson, who backs up Jalen Tabor. second down and 12. And Felipe Franks gets another chance out there. And on the slant, his third interception thrown tonight. Duke Dawson second, and it's going to go for a pick six. This is a nightmare spring game for Felipe Franks. 30-yard pick six for Duke Dawson, and a teachable moment for the young early enrollee with so much upside. What a night he's going to want to forget.
Jim McElwain does such a good job with his quarterbacks. When things aren't going well, he pulls you aside and he says, look, you're going to be okay. Things are going to be fine. He's also willing to pull you aside when things are going great and say, you know what, hey, that one incompletion you threw wasn't good enough. He knows how to manage the personalities in the room. He's done so in the National Football League, done so at the college level with remarkable success, and he's going to have his hands and fingerprints all over Felipe Franks, Trask, Appleby, and Del Rio here over the course of the summer.
Greg, there's probably going to be a time years from now where we look back at a video like this and say, remember how he started his career? He's got a bright future ahead.
He does.
But this is what it is tonight.
And he missed it just a little bit in front. I mean, these things happen. This is not a moment in which you're going to look at and say, man, that's a bad decision, that's a bad throw. No, it's just a little bit off, maybe 6 inches. But that's the margin for error at this level, and especially within this conference. He's going against arguably the most talented secondary in the SEC with backup wide receivers. Sometimes you have to take things into account and recognize what he's up against. And he's going to have a lot better nights than tonight here in the Swamp, and there's no reason to get down. His career is young. Sky's still the limit for the talented freshman.
Offensive coordinator Doug Nussmeier said of Franks when we asked about him and said, hey, give us a scouting report as to where he is. He says, listen, he may not have all the right answers right now, but he'll feel his way through. But there are going to be those tragic oh-no moments. There have been three of them tonight.
Happens to everybody. It doesn't matter how talented you are. This game will humble you quickly. And I can tell you one thing. As a guy that's been in his shoes, there is not a chance on earth that I could have possibly come out here as a senior in high school, gone against a secondary of this caliber with a backup offense, and excelled. This is tough sledding, but it's also very teachable. And he understands, and look, now you can evaluate him as much as ever. What will he do moving forward?
Three interceptions, four attempts, Felipe Franks. We've seen all four quarterbacks tonight. And now another chance to get an extended look at the other true freshman, Kyle Trask. Young man from Manville, Texas. The interesting recruiting backstory. Playing second fiddle. Wasn't even the starting quarterback on his own high school team. Derek King, a great athlete recruit for TCU, who won't play quarterback there as there was a mishandle of the quarterback snap exchange there. They ran a quarterback run-based offense back at Manville, Texas, so Trask was the backup, but he was a star at camps.
One thing that I think Doug Nussmeier and Jim McElwain really liked about it is the fact that he didn't go and transfer as a high school player. He said, look, this is where I go to school. This is the hand I've been dealt. I'm going to make the most of it. And he clearly did so while he was at camp, resulted in several college scholarships. Now he looks as though he has solidified the third-string spot based on the performance of tonight's game.
Here's Trask. As he gets his running back out of the backfield, Jordan Scarlett, who is met by Johnson, who's been very active tonight.
It's going to be interesting to see some of the guys that step up for this Florida Gator defense. Obviously, we know about the six departures. Jonathan Bullard, probably a first-round pick. Keanu Neal, Vernon Hargraves. Several guys that are teetering right there between the first and second round. Amongst others, Alex McAllister, Antonio Morrison, who was the heartbeat of the team as he came back from an ACL surgery last year.
You start going through those names, Greg, and I marvel at just how much talent was here in Gainesville a year ago. And now a new group of young talented players who will emerge. C.C. Jefferson among them, who was a huge recruit just a year ago.
You want to win in this league, this better be arguably your best position. Defensive line. Brian Cox, huge personality, 10.5 tackles for a loss last year. They're expecting huge things out of him, taking the next step. See Caleb Brantley, he is the workhorse inside, came back, thought about going to the NFL for a millisecond, decided it was in his best interest to return, and of course, who could forget the talented freshman from a year ago, now sophomore, CeCe Jefferson, who's filling in the Bullard spot. They have a good group up front. And a lot of guys, those names you haven't heard of yet, but you will know them very well come fall.
He is a 42-yarder.
Big Caleb Brantley. Coach Mack was quick to say this is a guy who's really grown up a lot, very talented. And he is the big man of that defensive line as Jim McElwain continues to coach up the squad. Blue team has taken advantage of the turnovers. 35-6. Speaking of coaching up the players, Coach Mack moments ago after Felipe Franks threw that third interception of his life.
Hey, Felipe, Felipe, come here. You're all right. You're all right. Now, did they go to opener? Was it open or closed?
Yeah, it was closed, but it was manned so I could work Vegas.
Okay, here's the deal now. Based on his alignment, right?
Yeah.
If you don't feel like it's a funnel technique, you always got the Canton versus closed. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
All right, so that's your easy throw, but you're good. Come back and make play, okay?
Yeah.
All right.
Greg, you were in the quarterback room with Coach Mack for many years with success. Break it down for us. What was just explained to young Mr. Franks?
So he was talking about open versus closed. That means whether or not there's one safety back deep or if there's two safeties back deep. That would direct which side you're going to go to. It rolled to close, meaning there was a free safety and a safety in the box, so he should have worked the Canton concept. Instead, he worked the Vegas concept. Didn't have the funnel technique, so it resulted in an interception. Missed the throw a little bit. With a more accurate pass, it's still a completion. You saw Coach Mack saying, look, this is how things are going to be done. It's a teachable moment. You can learn from every rep, and that's something Felipe Franks will learn from.
And as the blue team is back out there with Austin Appleby, and he's going to be sacked. When you think about Franks and where he should be in this stage of development, an early enrollee, and you hear what the coaching moment was, is he ready for that? Is that a situation where it surprises you that he didn't read it the right way, or you understand at this stage of development why he wouldn't read it the right way?
Given the way his day started, I think he's picking and sticking. He trusted the slant route by the junior receiver, Alvin Bailey. Alvin Bailey didn't really win, so he picked it and he stuck with it. And he paid the consequence, unfortunately. When you're searching for answers, when your head's swimming just a little bit, you try to identify and make the throws that you're most comfortable with. We saw Franks throw a couple good slants in warm-ups today. That's clearly a route he likes. That's one he wants to throw, and he tried to hit it. So he'll learn, and you sometimes have to allow the defense to dictate, which as a quarterback, it's not always the most fun thing to do, but something you learn
from. False start. Offense, number 51. 5-yard penalty. It remains second down.
That's Antonio Riles, the left guard. We haven't talked a lot about the offensive line today. The big story there is the absence of Martez Ivy, who underwent shoulder surgery, came in as a true freshman, was one of the biggest recruits landed in the country. But as it stands right now, Ivy potentially could move out to left tackle, perhaps his more natural position, but these would be the five that you would project, wouldn't it be, Greg?
It would be. And David Sharp had a pretty decent year last year, has been a little up and down over the course of the spring. Cam Dillard at center, still coming into his own as a leader. And then on the right side, Fred Johnson, probably going to eventually become the bell cow, maybe the most talented of the guys returning. Just be interesting once we see Martez Ivy at full strength, because the last eight games of the 2015 season, he didn't play very well, but that was the result of having shoulder issues on both sides. Him fully healthy, they're very excited what he can eventually become.
You know, think about a young man, a true freshman, playing on the offensive line and knowing what he was going up against down the stretch of the season. Match up against Florida State, match up against Bama's defensive front. A lot was being asked of him.
And Michigan, who's got a really good defensive front as well. The point of emphasis up front is communication. Too many mistakes last year in communication. That's very teachable, and it's very easy to fix as long as you have the guys that are coming back and they're comfortable playing with together.
Here's Austin Appleby on 3rd and 8 as he tried to muscle the ball that time to Ryan Sousa, but it goes incomplete.
A little behind on the throw right there. Tighten up the accuracy just a little bit on those in-breaking routes.
Boy, they are not bashful at all when it comes to sending Eddie Pinheiro out there. This is the new toy in the toy chest, and they're going to use it. Pinheiro once again with a long attempt. Missed from 54, but made from 52 and 46. And this a 56-yard attempt now for the JUCO transfer, Eddie Pinheiro. Right at the kick, and it is a delay of game. And as the 56-yarder attempt went through.
56. Eddie's saying, back it up. Well, I'm Eddie, good from 77. Let's
Eddie's
go.
Eddie's got the leg for a 61-yarder. They decline it, so the field goal is good.
That was an effortless
swing,
gonna
give him credit
too,
for it.
Man. Yeah.
Easy Eddie. Three field goals tonight. 52, 46, and 56. Hey, Florida fans, kicking woes, problem solved. Meet Eddie.
Adjustments to his stance. J.J. Schwartz getting heated up. He can be so much power in the middle of that lineup. And then if you look at their pitching staff, once again, a great start from Logan Shore. You've got A.J. Puck. You've got Alex Fiedo. The list goes on and on, not to mention two freshmen that come in, Brady Singer and Jackson Coar, who would be anybody else's weekend starters. And, you know, Kevin O'Sullivan's able to use them out of the pen and use them in long relief if he needs to. So this is a Florida Gators baseball team that's primed and ready for a postseason run. It's just going to be a matter of how far they can go, and it looks like Kevin O'Sullivan's ready to manage them well.
Laura, you just decided for me my Sunday viewing plans. I appreciate that. I got to dial in the Gators now.
Laura, I think you should do some homework on the Gators baseball. That was outstanding.
I mean, is anybody better
than
Rutledge?
That was unbelievable.
I mean, anybody better than Rutledge when it comes to college baseball?
That was as good as it gets.
I got to keep up with you guys. I got to bring something to the table, you know?
That was awesome.
Here's Trask. And he gets it complete downfield as Case Harrison makes his way to the 40-yard line. Former walk-on locally from Gainesville High School.
Making the switch from running back to wide receiver. Worked out well for Brandon Powell last year. Case Harrison trying to be the 2016 edition of Brandon Powell.
I'll tell you, there are things to like about the true freshman early enrollee Kyle Trask.
There are things to love, and I don't use that word lightly. I think he is playing very well. He did so yesterday at practice, also very much in command, playing as though he belongs. That's the big thing. He absolutely belongs, and I think that is very clear based on the performance tonight.
Downfield shot again, and nearly off the deflection into the hands of Josh Heyman, but the extremely talented senior free safety Marcus May was there in coverage.
Yeah, a little surprised that Marcus May decided to return. He had such a huge season last year after forcing 5 fumbles. I know he thought long and hard about coming back, but wanted to be the workhorse, and he's doing his part right here. You see Trask just not getting all of it. Didn't get through it all the way as a result. Ball came up a little short. He had Hammond, who they're excited about, at wide receiver on the outside. Marcus May, though, more often than not, he's going to come down with it. He is an explosive player at the safety spot for the Gators.
May's been getting some time at various positions in the defensive backfield this spring. Second down and 10.
Seeing the audible by the freshman too, getting up into it.
And that time getting around the edge was Brian Cox.
And
Jeff Collins, the defensive coordinator, told us, listen, Brian Cox, arguably the hardest playing player I've ever been around. Really fun guy to coach, you get the sense.
He loves practice. He loves it. And he's the type of guy, as a senior, that all these young early enrollees, all 12 of them, they're looking at number 94, and they're saying, if he's a senior and he's as productive as he's been, and he's practicing this hard, what am I doing? Jeff Collins, Jim McElwain, everybody is feeding off the energy that Brian Cox brings every single day, and he's got to step it up because they have lost some very big players up front.
Cox had 10.5 TFLs a year ago. Trask again, once again, pressure coming off the edge as he was able to step forward. No whistle yet, and then finally, as Trask made his way down to the 17-yard line.
Pretty good run. Say they replaced him back at high school at Manville with a good athlete. Clearly, he could have run that offense as well. You see him escaping, not liking everything. Hey, north-south, let's go. Don't try to get outside. Vertical. They're going to blow him dead at around the 36, which I don't necessarily agree with, but good heady play from the freshman.
You know, Coach Mack, during the recruiting process, was having a conversation with the high school coach from Manville, and he said, listen, please don't think I'm nuts, but my backup quarterback. Little did he know that that conversation would extend to be an early enrollee in Kyle Trask. Well, here's Big Leg Eddie again, Greg.
I want to get back to that Kyle Trask story. The high school coach said, I know there's going to be a 30 for 30 about me.
That's right.
Here
That's
in
right.
20 years, and I'm going to be the guy that did not play Kyle Trask. That's how much faith he has in this young man, and he's proven worthy tonight of having that praise.
52-yard attempt now from Eddie Pinero. 3 for 4, his only miss was 54. They're already chanting Eddie. It's the spring game, the first time they're seeing him. And he pulled out of that one a little bit and went out to the right.
One thing that's big,
though, can he muscle it?
Yeah, one thing that's big, though, is last year Austin Harden, poor guy, he allowed one missed kick to affect the next.
That's exactly correct. It got in his head.
It did. And Eddie Pinero, he hasn't allowed that to happen. Yeah, he's missed a couple tonight, but you know what? He came right back, drained a 56-yarder, didn't bother him. It's like he's unaffected by any negative outcomes, and surely he's disappointed, of course, but he's going to come back out there tomorrow or later in the game today and say, hey, I'm going to give it a swing and rip it just like I did the first few.
Greg, I know two of us are the third. Sean White and Jeremy Johnson still very much in the mix and looking productive at Auburn. Here's Felipe Franks again, and this time he gets it completed to Ciante Lewis. As I think Franks could use a little bit of positive momentum here in this final minute as they go hurry up. 2-minute drill for the early enrollee Franks. 3 interceptions thrown tonight by the true freshman.
It's a good throw right there. Just get him in rhythm. Get him heading to the summer feeling good about the direction that he's heading.
And another completion, easy pitch and catch to Lewis, sophomore tight end, who looks like he's going to play a big role for the Gators this year. Remember, they lost Jake McGee, was their second leading receiver. Young man who transferred in from Virginia, suffered through the injury, came back last year and was very productive. And now Goolsby, who had a touchdown tonight, and here's Ciante Lewis, who missed several games last year with an injury, but should be very productive.
Let's not forget Cameron Knight. He's a big body, probably going to be in that traditional Y attached to the end of the line of scrimmage tight end. And Morrill Stevens, who's got an awful lot of explosive capability as well. It's a good tight end room.
There's 2nd and 6 now for Franks. As he looks to extend the play. And then throws it out of bounds. Half minute remaining here in the orange and blue debut. And it is the debut of Franks and Trask, the two early enrollee quarterbacks. Franks threw the pick 6 to Duke Dawson. Trask has had more managed drives. Star of the night passing wise has been Luke Del Rio, who is with the ones out there starting the game. 176 yards and two touchdown throws for Del Rio. There is Luke, who has never started a college football game, but a good chance that may change come September 3rd when UMass is here in Gainesville. Third and six for Franks. And a first down to Lewis again. I think Lewis is a nice crutch to lean on right now for Mr. Franks, isn't he?
When you're a young player, find that tight end. That's good learning for everyone that wants to play this position at this level. Find your tight end. The bigger the body, the bigger the catch radius, the easier it is to be effective at the position.
Timeout used here. Leaving 22 seconds on the clock. You know, we mentioned the fact that Felipe Franks could use a little bit of a boost heading into the summer. Well, perhaps this drive could be it, Greg.
Yeah, I mean, look, you don't have to be a superstar the first time you step out on campus. All you need to know is that you're getting better. And that's what I think this entire team's approach is going to be. How can I get better today? How can I improve where I was this morning? Where can I be tomorrow? That's what you have to be. And if you attack each day that way, and I know Jim McElwain's stressing to his guys that that's the approach they need to have. If you attack it that way, you're going to be successful. There's enough talent on this team to win a championship. Now, will the execution, will the mentality, will the leadership, will all the other intangibles fill out? That's the big question that remains.
Let's see how Felipe Franks manages these final 22 seconds. It looked like there was some movement up front. We mentioned UMass on September 3rd. Critical game September 24th on the road at Tennessee. The permanent crossover, of course, is the always difficult SEC West rival LSU. And the rotating crossover from the SEC West gets them a trip at Arkansas in November.
It's a very balanced schedule, though. If I'm Jim McElwain, I'm thrilled with the way this thing laid out. You have three games at home to work in whatever new quarterback you have. Then you have Vanderbilt on the road, which will be or Tennessee on the road, which will be tough. Vanderbilt on the road. You, of course, have the neutral site game against Georgia, but a couple tough games in each month, and sure enough, you might find the Florida Gators back in the SEC championship game.
And that was a good throw by Franks, but a drop by Ciante Lewis.
It's a really good throw right there. A really, really good throw. I mean, this is a big league throw. Right now, Felipe Franks is a little bit more of a thrower than he is a passer. But right here, he has some things you just can't teach. That's a big league arm, very accurate, got to catch it. If you're Ciante Lewis, you have a young player that's trying to find himself.
How much, when you look at that delivery, do you say they have to shorten up his motion, though, Greg?
They do, and it's not because of the timing. I think he has enough arm strength to make up for it. But it's because of the inaccuracies. And when you're low and you're dipping it that way and you don't have that tight release, sometimes the longer the release, much like a golf swing, the longer the backswing, the more problems that can happen. Same thing with a quarterback. Same thing with a release like that. When it drops down, it's tough to always be accurate. So tightening it up so he can be more accurate is going to be the most important thing for Doug Nussmeier and Jim McElwain as they move forward with Felipe Franks.
Franks runs for a first down, steps out with 7 seconds remaining in the game. Doug Nussmeier, the offensive coordinator, has worked with him a lot this spring. He says, listen, he's got the pure size, got the arm strength, the natural ability, but the learning curve is steep. So much is new to him. Through 3 interceptions tonight, pick six was returned by Duke Dawson, but here, settling down on this final drive is Felipe Franks.
And let's be honest, he came in with big expectations, and that wasn't necessarily the case for Kyle Trask. So probably feeling the pressure this spring. And for the most part, the coach has been very pleased with him. Just needs to figure out a way to build on today.
Yeah, Sousa was the intended target there. 4 seconds remain.
Doug Nussmeier giving the play.
Nussmeier, former Alabama play caller, and went to Michigan. Brady Hoke now here with Jim McElwain at Florida.
Felt like there was unfinished business.
Nussmeier, a great quarterback himself in college.
Felt like there was unfinished business at the end of last season. Had an opportunity to actually turn down the Southern Miss head coaching position. Felt like he had more to do here in Gainesville. And the way the offense has looked for the most part, they're off to a good start.
Well, they'd love to see Franks cap this night, and it would be great for him. And he does just that. Ciante Lewis, touchdown catch. So he'll leave on a good note, Greg.
How huge. I mean, it's exactly what we talked about at the end of the first half. We said, look, it's not about where you start. It's about where you finish. This right here teaches me more about Felipe Franks' competitiveness than anything. Look, you're going to make mistakes as a freshman. It's part of learning the position. It's the toughest position in all of sports. Felipe Franks had a couple tough throws, had a couple of unfortunate circumstances. He gets the last laugh with a great throw to the outside shoulder to his go-to guy, Ciante Lewis, on that drive. And he'll head into the summer feeling good about everything.
We got a good look at all four quarterbacks. We'll hear what Coach McElwain has to say about them. When we return, Laura will be with Coach Matt here at the Orange and Blue debut in Gainesville. Stay with us. It's tonight, 176 yards and two touchdowns, and led the blue team on four touchdown drives as the quarterback competition at the end of the spring game. These were the final numbers. They will head into fall camp with the two veterans and then the two freshmen still pushing hard to see who will be the new starter for the Gators. The man who will have that answer come the end of August is with Laura.
Thanks, Joe. And Coach, what type of separation after tonight did you see between Luke Del Rio and Austin Appleby?
You know, I saw both guys do a lot of good things. Obviously, I think, you know, Luke did a pretty darn good job of just taking what they were giving him and not trying to, you know, make stuff up. And I like that. I thought Austin really came in and did some good things. He moved that second unit there, and we got points. You know, it'll be interesting to kind of look and see where his eyes were. Both young guys, you know, they had fun out here. And for them to be able to play in the swamp on a Friday, you know, on a night game like this, that's really, that's priceless.
Felipe Franks finished on a high note. What will your message be to him following this game?
You know, it's one of those deals where the importance of taking care of the ball and understanding that's the most important thing we own is that football. So he'll learn from it. You can tell, though, both those young guys got really good arms. And you know what? That allows us an opportunity to get a little bit better.
So many more tools than you had this time last year. Four quarterbacks, four running backs. The list goes on and on. Talent throughout. How are you feeling as spring comes to a close?
Well, I tell you what, we got a little bit better. And that's all you can ask. And, you know, I don't know. We'll look at the film. I'll get angry. There's a couple things on my mind right now that I'm about ready to get them on.
What are those things?
Get back in. I'll keep that to myself. But, you know, overall, we just had a wonderful spring. And I mean that sincerely. I can only think of maybe 1.5 practices that our guys didn't come out and really try to get better. And, you know, with that, that's kind of part of the learning curve.
All right. Thanks, Coach. And Joe, a Gator team that got better.
No doubt about it, Laura. They did indeed. I mean, he's not going to have many problems with some of his defensive stars as well. Duke Dawson had two interceptions. Jared Davis had seven total tackles. Greg McElroy, your big takeaway from the Florida spring game?
Look, nothing's settled. I mean, these competitions are ongoing. You heard Coach McElwain address the fact that Del Rio took what the defense gave him, but he was running with the ones against the two defense. Appleby, on the other hand, running with the twos against the one defense, a talented one defense, mind you. So this is far from being done, but if I'm a Florida Gator fan, I am thrilled with what I just witnessed. A lot of answered questions and a lot of things to look forward to in 2016.
Especially with the uptick at quarterback, the great improvement at place kicker, and you know the talent they have on defense. 44-6, our final score of the blue team. That's it from the Florida spring game. Enjoy the rest of your evening, everybody.